Welcome to Unity of Charlotte, where our mission is to nurture a deep and mature experience of God through the practice of unity principles. Simply put, we are here to love, serve, and grow. I'm Lawrence Tolliver, one of the members of your board of trustees here in Charlotte, and I am so glad you chose to join us here today on Zoom or YouTube. So let us start today's service by sharing our statement of oneness and let that lead into our opening prayer for this fine Sunday. Together, if you will, there is one presence and one power in my life and universe, God the good omnipotent. And so, please join me for the morning prayer. Father, Mother God, we come knowing that you are always present everywhere. When we look into each other's faces, we see you expressing yourself whole, perfect, complete, and fulfilled. Father, Mother God, we're doing all that we can to be present ourselves for this moment. For this moment is supreme in our lives, for it is a present moment. We are not going to concern ourselves with yesterday's issues, nor are we going to anticipate issues for the next hour. We are going to focus our attention on you and your divine presence and your divine openness and responsiveness to each of us. There is great news to come forth every moment now. We have a wonderful speaker on our calendar today. We have learned so much from her in the past, and we anticipate much right now. Father, Mother God, we have survived the year 2020, and many would say that we have achieved many lofty goals during that year. So we celebrate. And we celebrate the opportunities unfolding before us today. That is why we are devoting our attention to now. We are conscious of what is being said and what is being felt by each of us right now. That is the prime moment for each of us as we continue to grow spiritually. As we continue to mature spiritually, this moment is ripe and pregnant with possibilities, possibilities that we embrace. Father, Mother God, we thank you for this time, and we know that all is well because all is love, all is you. And so it is. Amen. So let us start today's service by, looking at, a few things that are going to be occurring. And I want to direct your attention to the proper place. We're going to be looking at a month that is full of activities. We have our dialogue as service, our men's group, our course in miracles, and our group meditation, collective meditation and affirmation functions that will occur on Sundays. I just direct you to our website, unityofcharlotte.org, where you can access many of the links to participate in our community's activities. Also, I do want to make sure that if you do not receive our weekly emails from Unity of Charlotte, please go to our website, again, unityofcharlotte.org, and you can subscribe to our emails there. Some of the Zoom links for our many activities can be accessed right there in the emails that you receive. And so it's important, if you do not receive them regularly, please subscribe to receive them. So you know that we do open our Zoom connections for Sunday services early so that you might talk with, meet with, share with other people, people you know, people that you normally are together with. So those lines will stay open. The Zoom link will stay open after the service so that you may continue to share with one another. So as normal, you know, we look forward to the day that we can return to our in-person services. I do want to announce that I got my first vaccination in January and looking forward to number two here in February. So those of you who might still be waiting, I just encourage you to continue to be positive about it and finding ways in which to link up for an appointment. I also understand that I do need to clarify a few things about the Board of Trustees meeting that took place after our wonderful annual meeting last Sunday. We were able, as a new Board of Trustees, to gather in a Zoom meeting and to select our officers for 2021. I am very proud to announce that Reverend Pat Dre is going to be our president for this year. And she actually twisted my arm, but I was happy to say yes when she nominated me to be both the vice president and the secretary for 2021. Now the secretary part is really what she wanted, because none of the women want to take notes. I mean, you may not know that, but I'll tell you right now, none of the women want to take notes. But I've learned how to do so, and I will continue to do so this year. And our secretary for 2021 is Chandan Singh. He has been a very active member of the board in 2020, and we're so glad that he is continuing to do that this year. Also, there have been additional steps taken to organize the board for effective service in 2021. First, let me announce to you all that Barbara Rolfe will be responsible for helping us to express fully our commitment as a congregation to being a mission-centric church. And some of you do know that we began on this path a couple of years ago, but we never finished. We never reached the point of full satisfaction about that. So Barbara Rolfe will be doing some activities with many of you who have already let her know that you are bought in to us being a mission-centric congregation. I want to also tell you that Michael Brown and also Maria Malave, I'm not saying that right. I'm going to ask my good friend, Alan, this Maria Malava is going to work with Michael Brown, and the two of them are going to focus on community building. You know, in a year when almost 12 months we've not been together in person. There is some work to do on community building. We know we love each other's company, and we want to find ways to reinforce our friendships and our togetherness and our collaborations with one another. So I do want to certainly remind everyone that Unity is a ministry of prayer throughout the world. And so those of you who have an interest and need to secure prayer have two directions to go. One is locally, by going to our website, again, unityofcharlotte.org, and indicating your need to have someone pray for you locally. Also, if you want to take advantage of Silent Unity, which has been going on for more than 100 years, you may do so by using your phone to dial 800-NOW-PRAY. That is 800-NOW-PRAY, where someone there at the Unity headquarters will be able to pray for you to realize exactly the life you choose to experience. So I do want to again tell you that we have a wonderful speaker today. She knows how to tell stories better than anyone I know except my mother, and she's not here anymore. But Reverend Sally Robbins, the great storyteller, the great metaphysician, and the compassionate woman who is really being very transparent, sharing her own personal life journey with us.
That I want to share with you. He says, this is how you be a force for good in the world. Number one, gain inner composure. Now, that's fabulous because I know that there's no way that I can be a force for good if I'm into the drama myself. Can you relate to that? And how many times have I been sucked into something where I'm no good to anyone because I've lost my inner composure? So his point here is so valid. The first thing we have to do is gain our inner composure so that we too can come from a place of activity, not reactivity. And so that is the most powerful place to start. Number two, he says, follow an inner rudder toward compassion. Now, he's the embodiment of compassion after what he has endured in his lifetime. And he is modeling that to us day in and day out. The compassion has to be that place from which we come. So knowing that everyone is doing their very best, even when we have unskilled behavior, people in front of us who are doing unloving and unkind things, that doesn't mean we're entitled to do that. That means that we too have to offer compassion to our fellow man and brothers and sisters. And number three, act now in whatever way you can. Not, yes, someday I'll get there. Someday I'll do that when I've got more time. No, now, this is the moment. And so I love this formula. Gain inner composure, follow an inner rudder toward compassion, and act now in whatever way you can. You know, if you wake up every morning and just simply say, Spirit, how can I serve today? How can I serve today? I guarantee you, you will have a day full of opportunities where you can serve. That might even be as simple as smiling at someone who hands you a cup of coffee. It might be as simple as being a powerful force for good in the lives of your children or grandchildren. But you will have the opportunity if you offer yourselves up and say, I am standing tall in this opportunity to be of service. And so I love what the Dalai Lama also says. He says, as human beings equipped with marvelous intelligence and the potential for developing a warm heart, each of us can become a force for good. He's not saying, you know, those of us who are in leadership roles, we can be that force for good. He says each of us has that chance to light up. And it starts right here with me. I have to be that force for good. And then I model that to everyone else and give them permission that they too can be a force for good. The Dalai Lama has put out a beautiful message just by living his life in the manner in which he has. There's another wonderful group that I want to tell you about. Their whole mission is to be a force for good. It's called the Elders. This group was formed in 2007 by Nelson Mandela. I took this snapshot off of their website, and you see the woman in the red jacket there. She is the former president of Ireland. So we're talking about heavy duty leaders, world leaders, global thought producers, people who are really out there. And they've all come together and decided at the coming together, because Nelson Mandela set this whole organization up. They want to be a force for good. And so they're a group of leaders. And I love the word says up in the upper right, working together for peace, justice, and human rights. Now, former President Jimmy Carter has served on their board. Desmond Tutu has served on their board. These are people who are working the back channels. They're talking to political leaders. They're talking to different countries. They're going into places where human rights are being just demolished. And they're saying, hey, this is our chance to step up and move into becoming that force for good in this world. They're quietly working in the background. And that's what Nelson Mandela wanted. Here's a man who spent 26, 27 years in a prison. And when he came out, instead of going, well, it's time for me to live the good life and I'll just retire, he said, no, I have work to do. I'm here and I'm going to be a force for good. And so when he started this wonderful organization, he told us to be free is not merely to cast off one's chains, but to live in a way that respects and enhances the freedom of others. My friends, it's time to go beyond ourselves. It's time to go, what's in this for me? How can I improve my life? Self-help is wonderful. And we're always on that path of determining how we can become better and uncover that magnificent spiritual being that's already there within each one of us. And yet, what I'm trying to get across today is that we have to move from that place of knowing our spiritual divinity and then opening up ourselves as a channel, a pure channel for love and peace and harmony and compassion and kindness. And as we do that, that's when the spark is lit and we see all of these other people joining us and saying, yes, I too want to be a power for good. So there's all kinds of ways that we can do that. Even businesses. Let me tell you about this business. It's called Custom Inc. I love this. It was a company started in 1999 by three former college classmates. And they got together. One was actually working on Wall Street. But he was so tired. He was making great money, but he went to work and then he'd come home and he would have like no sense of mission or purpose or being that force for good that he really wanted to be. So he got with his two other classmates, his former classmates, and they said, you know, we're going to create a company that's devoted to being good and being a good force in this world. So they created Custom Inc. They just started making t-shirts and creating custom t-shirts that they would, you know, give out to people. And then they started selling them. And now they're one of the largest custom imprint organizations in the world. It's just amazing what they have done in a short 20 years. And I love their logo. See that logo up in the left-hand corner? There's a very specific reason that they chose to put an octopus as their mascot in their logo. And the reason why is that an octopus has three hearts. It has three hearts in its body. One is pumping the blood, and one is pumping the water that it shoots out and moves itself. And so the three hearts, these three classmates, when they said, when we're starting this company, we want to have heart. We want to have a heart-centered business. And so they've partnered with companies or nonprofits like Make-A-Wish. That's what this picture is here, where their employees are encouraged to go out and volunteer. They provide time for them to volunteer, and then shirts and the ways to make it happen, so that they're not just focused on are their bottom line. They're focused on how can they be a partner in their communities and in their world. Their company has heart. And I love that whole idea that's who I want to spend my dollars. I'm going to vote with my dollars. Companies like that are people that I want to spend my money with, who are focused on being a good neighbor, being a force for good in this world. And so I know that their Three Hearts Initiative, which is what they created to become this volunteer force for good, there are all these charitable activities, things like Make-A-Wish, partnering with them. This is their opportunity from that top down to model to their employees, you have more than a responsibility than just showing up for your job. You have a responsibility for saying, I'm here to be a force for good in this world as well. Here's another story I want to share with you. This man's name is Richard Montañez. Now, Richard grew up in the 60s in a rural part of California where there's mostly farmland. And his family had been on that farmland for years, and they picked grapes and they did a lot of the itinerant work that is there, the seasonal work that is there, barely eking out a living. That's what he started doing as a child. But he went to school. He did not know how to speak English. It was very difficult for him because he would go to school and he'd struggle. He spoke Spanish, and it was very hard for him to even understand what the teachers were saying. But one day when he was quite young, and it was like the second or third grade, the teacher asked the students, stand up and tell us what you want to become. What is your wish to become in this world? And the other students started standing up, and one said, I want to be an astronaut. And the other said, I want to be a veterinarian. And they were going over there around the room, and Richard realized he didn't know what that meant. He had never thought about dreaming about what he could be. And he decided in that moment that he had to make a difference. Now, he dropped out of school shortly after that. He dropped out in the fourth grade. This was, he could barely read and write. And so he went to work out with his family and was trying to help the family survive. He worked in a poultry factory for a while and just did all kinds of odd jobs. But in 1976, when he was 18 years old, he heard about an opportunity. There was a nearby Frito-Lay factory that was looking for a janitor. Now, he couldn't fill out a resume or fill out an application, but so we got someone to help him do that. He submitted the application, and lo and behold, they called him in for an interview and he got the job. And he remembered the first day that he went to go start his new job at the Frito-Lay factory as a janitor. His grandfather pulled him aside and he said, I want you to know that if you're going to be a janitor, be the best janitor you know how to be, and make those floors shine. Make them know that a Montañez mopped those floors. And he instilled in Richard that you could be the very best at whatever you were doing. Didn't matter the job. So Richard goes into his job and he started deciding, you know, I'm going to learn not only my job, I'm going to do my job really well, but I'm going to find out what else is going on in this factory. And he would go down to the factory floor where they were making Cheetos. That was one of the products that this Frito-Lay plant did. And he would watch the assembly line and he just tried to learn as much as he could about all of the things that were going on in that plant. One day he asked one of the salespeople if he could go with him when they were stocking convenience store shelves. And so he goes with a salesperson and he sees that, you know, there's Lay's potato chips and there's Cheetos. And then right next to that, there was a, they were in a Hispanic neighborhood, and he saw that there was all these Mexican spices. It was a rack of Mexican spices. And he realized in that moment, there's nothing that Frito-Lay has for the Latino community. And he started thinking about that. Shortly after that, the president of Frito-Lay, because this was now during the 80s and Frito-Lay was falling upon some hard times, the president put out a video, and he said to his employees, because he was really trying to make sure that he was boosting morale, he said to them, Roger Enrico was the name of the CEO at the time, and he said in his video, "You are all owners. We are all owners in this, not just, you know, the head echelon. We are all owners. Act like an owner." So Richard took that to heart. He remembered how he'd seen the spices, and so he took one day one of the Cheetos machines broke down, and it was making the Cheetos without putting that orange dust on it, you know, that when you eat Cheetos, you get all that orange all over your hands. And so he took a bunch of those Cheetos that were undusted. He took them home and he started putting chili pepper and a few other secret spices that he made like a blend, and he started giving it out to friends, and his friends and his family really liked these Cheetos. And they're like, "Wow, where can we get this?" And he goes, "Well, I'm just trying something here." So he put this together, and he thought, you know what, I'm Roger Enrico tells us, you know, we're all owners, so I'm just going to talk to him. And he decided, you know, I'm going to call the CEO and tell him my idea. So he literally called, because he had a company directory and he hadn't been told, you can't call the president. So he decided, I'm going to call the president. I'm going to read you how he tells how this dialogue went. He says, he calls the number and an assistant answers, "Mr. Enrico's office. Who is this?" "Richard Montanez." "What division are you with, Richard?" "California." "Oh, you're the VP overseeing California?" "No, I work at the Rancho Cucamonga plant." "Oh, so you're the VP of operations?" "No, I work inside the plant." "Oh, you're the plant manager?" "No, I'm the janitor." And the assistant went, "Oh, please hold." And a few minutes later, Roger Enrico accepted his call and said, "Hello, this is Roger. How can I help you?" So Montanez told the CEO, "You know, I have this idea, and I'd love to come and talk to you about this idea. And I think it's a wonderful way for you to expand into a whole, really serve an underserved population. And I think that we can really make a hit with this." And Roger said, to his credit, said, "You know what? In 2 weeks, I will be at your plant and let's have a meeting." And so 2 weeks later, Richard Montanez went out and paid $3 for a tie because he didn't own a tie. He puts a tie on. He took some of these homemade Cheetos that he had. He put them in baggies and then sealed them with his iron that he used for clothes. He hand drew a logo on the front of it. And he had 30 of these bags ready to give out to the executives who were coming to hear his presentation. He didn't know what a presentation was. He didn't know how to do it. He went to a library, bought a book on marketing presentation, literally copied everything from that, and he put it on transparencies, because back then they used overheads, you know, so they put them on transparencies. So he had his transparencies, he had his tie, he had his baggies of Cheetos, and he walks into the room, nervous as all get out. And he said, "You know, I just thought, I'm just going to do this." He said, "I was shaking in my boots, but I knew I had to do this." So he starts his presentation, and then he's handed out the Cheetos, and people are munching on them. And then one of the executives in the meeting said to him, "How much market share do you think you can get?" Now, Montanez thought for a second. He said, I had no idea what he was talking about or what I was doing. He said, I was shaking. I literally was shaking. But I opened up my arms and I went, this much market share. He held his arms way out wide. And so the room went silent as the CEO stood up and he smiled. And Richard and Rico said, ladies and gentlemen, do you realize we have an opportunity to go after this much market share? And he stretched out his arms just like Richard had. He then turned to Montanez and he said, put that mop away. You're coming with us. So at that point, they invited Richard to come in. He helped develop this new product, and he was put in charge of making sure that this was going to be a success. This, ladies and gentlemen, became lit flaming hot Cheetos, which now is a huge sensation. They've even got all different kinds of flaming hot. It's become a brand unto itself. And Richard was overseeing all of this. And all of a sudden they went into a whole new market they had never had before. All because Richard decided he wanted to be an instrument for good for his underserved community. Now, Flaming Hot Cheetos has become a real cult thing. Let me show you. If you go to the Cheetos website, I'm not making this stuff up. There really are things that they have recipes for this. People put it in their tacos. They put it in their popcorn. They put it on top of their mac and cheese, and they even put it on their pizza. Again, I'm not making this stuff up. People are doing this. They love this stuff. And they've sold millions and millions and millions of dollars worth. And Richard went on to have a very successful executive career with Frito-Lay. He's now going out doing speeches all over the country, all over the world, to show people that they too can be an instrument for good. They too can do this. And I love what Ernest Holmes says about this, because Richard just kept his eye on the prize. He just kept saying, I'm going to go out and I'm going to do this. Ernest Holmes tells us our work will best be done in quiet expectancy and in calm confidence. The results rest in the eternal law of good. See, there's an eternal law of good that if we rest assured, knowing that the universe is always conspiring for our good, if that's our expectation, there is a law of expectancy. That's what he's talking about here. In quiet expectancy, I know that I can be a powerful force for good, because the law of expectancy says good is showing up in my life all the time. Even when it doesn't look like it, I know that I can be a powerful force for good. Let me tell you about another wonderful opportunity that came to several truckers one day. This happened back in 2018. And this is an interstate. It's actually I-696 right outside of Detroit. And at 1 a.m. in the morning, the highway patrol got a call that there was a man up on an overpass. You see him in this slide. You see him over on the right side there. He's in white. He was up on that overpass saying he was going to commit suicide and throw himself down onto the road below. Well, the troopers immediately asked these truckers to pull into each of these lanes. There's 13 trucks there. And so they all said, yep, we're going to do this. And what that did was that prevented him, even if he did jump, it would be a much lower until he hit, because he was going to hit one of those trucks. And it showed that there were people who cared, and that gave the police just enough time, you know, to talk to him. And eventually went to them with them to the hospital, where he was treated. And these truckers, the police actually came out to each of these truckers and shook their hands at the end of this. It took several hours for this to unravel, because they shut down the interstate that entire time. But these truckers had an opportunity to be an instrument for good. They were just driving their load that night. They were just wanting to get on their way. And yet Spirit dropped right into their lap the opportunity to be an instrument for good. And they all said, yes, yes, and we'll stay here and make sure that this happens. This is when we know that we have so many wonderful chances. Once we say, I'm going to do this, the universe opens up a tremendous chance for us to say, wow, I can go for it here, here, and here. There's unlimited good there. Here's one of my favorite professors. His name is Minor Myers Jr. He's the former president of Illinois Wesleyan University. And he was a very popular professor there for a long time. He said, go into the world and do well, but more importantly, go into the world and do good. His classes were so popular that there was a waiting list to get into his classes. His students loved him. But what I love about this is that he was not only telling, go out and make your mark on the world. He said, go out and do what you're passionate about. The money will come if you just follow your heart and do good. Here's someone, I wish someone had said that to me in college. There's very few professors who are willing to make that statement. And so this man, not only did he say that to his students loved him for it because he was coming from that place where he was showing them that he was an instrument of good and they could be as well. So we've heard about individuals. We've heard about groups. We've heard about companies coming together to be an instrument for good. What about countries? Can countries be an instrument for good? Let me tell you about New Zealand. New Zealand decided that they were going to not only take care of their own people, because of course that's the country's first promise, that they're going to take care of their constituency, but they decided they were going to take care of their neighbors as well. So as the vaccines became available to the countries in the world to purchase so that they could vaccinate their constituency, New Zealand decided, you know what? There are several neighboring islands around us that may not have the financial resources to buy these vaccines. And because our people travel back and forth, their people travel back and forth, we wanna do good. We wanna be an instrument for good in this world. We're not only going to vaccinate our population, we're gonna buy enough vaccines for several other countries that are out there, other principalities. So they bought sufficient vaccines. I'm gonna read this because they just decided they were going to go above and beyond being an instrument of good for their own country. They're not going to impact others. They bought enough vaccines for Tokelau, Niue, the Cook Islands, and Samoa, Tonga, and Tuvalu. And they made the offer to all of these islands and principalities and said, we've got enough vaccines. If you'd like to take advantage of this, if you don't have the financial resources, we're going to help you. Now, isn't that incredible that their leadership of their country decided, not only are we going to take care of our own, we're going to take care of others too. Boy, we can really learn from that. We can really learn that I'm in it for myself. That's a dead idea. That's long over gone. It's time now for us all to step up and say, I'm here to be in service to the world. How can I be in service? Janet Stanfield, a wonderful New Thought musician, says, I cannot do all the good that the world needs, but the world needs all the good that I can do. Isn't that a great way to look at it? Because sometimes I think, well, what impact can I make? Well, guess what? I can make a big impact if I just start with me. Just start with me. And then it grows from there. I have to be the change that I wish to see, as Mahatma Gandhi said. It has to start with me. That's all I have control over. And then the momentum will sweep the world, just like my breaking news. It'll sweep, just like the pandemic. I want to be the impetus. I want to be the catalyst for all the good that can come from me, through me, out into the world. I'm going to close with a story that I know you probably saw, but it just so wonderfully encapsulates how yet one individual can make a stand and a powerful stand for good. This is Reverend Andy Kim. He is the representative in the House of Representatives for New Jersey. And he was there on January 6th when the insurrection happened at the Capitol and all that bedlam was going on. And then after they cleared the Capitol of the rioters, all of the legislators went into their houses of Congress and made sure that they secured the vote and they did what they had to do, and that went late into the night. And as they were all leaving, as Representative Andy Kim was walking back through the rotunda, as he walked through it, he saw the mess that had been left. There was just stuff strewn all over the place. And he saw a couple of National Guards soldiers there, and they were putting things in trash bags, and they were just picking up and trying to get things back to some semblance of order. So he walked over to the National Guardsman and he said, "Could I have a bag?" And they said, "Sure." Now, this is like 1-2 in the morning. And everyone's dog tired. And he just decided, you know what? I'm going to do my part. And I love what he said when he was interviewed about this later. He said, "When you see something you love that's broken, you want to fix it. I love the Capitol. I'm honored to be there," he said. "This building is extraordinary. And the rotunda in particular is just awe-inspiring. How many countless generations have been inspired in that room?" He said, "It really broke my heart, and I just felt compelled to do something. What else could I do?" So he got down on his hands and knees. He started picking up backpacks and all kinds of stuff that had just been left. And as he did so, he wasn't doing it for attention. He didn't know that someone was taking pictures of him as he was doing this. And one of his fellow New Jersey representatives happened to walk by as he was doing this. And Representative Tom Malinowski told a reporter later, "There were a couple of National Guardsmen, and I noticed somebody on his hands and knees leaning under a bench to pick something up. And it was Andy all by himself, just quietly removing debris and putting it in a plastic bag. He was clearly not doing it for an audience." Malinowski went on to say, "It was for me the most poignant moment of the long night." So when Representative Andy Kim was out there just saying, "I'm going to be an instrument for good," even if that's just putting trash away, that inspired his fellow Democrats, Republicans, didn't matter. It inspired his fellow congressmen that's what they were there to do, is to be a force for good. I'll close with this quote by John Wesley. "Do all the good you can, in all the ways you can, to all the souls you can, in every place you can, at all the times you can, with all the zeal you can, as long as ever you can." As long as ever you can. That's a pretty broad swipe of our orders, our marching orders here. And that's what I want to take to heart today. I hope you do too. That as we move further into 2021, it's already February, we can do so much good if we simply say yes. We can do so much good by moving back into that divine stream of good and kindness and compassion, love, harmony. All of that is so available to us if we simply open our hearts, open our minds, and say, "I too am going to be a powerful force for good in this community and in this world." So I invite you this week, be open to this powerful idea of being a force for good in this world. It's up to us, and we can do it. Have a fabulous week, everyone. I love you. Namaste. And I'm going to turn this back over to our beloved Lawrence Tolliver. Thank you, Lawrence, for closing us out.
Well, I'll tell you this. That had to move everybody that saw and heard it. And I have breaking news, too. Reverend Sally, the good you do is good for all. Can it be any other way for believers in unity? We are all one. We begin the service with a statement of oneness. So the good each of us does is good for all. What a blessed concept to embrace. What wonderful breaking news and what great marching orders we got this morning from the great storyteller, Reverend Sally. Thank you from the bottom of our hearts for such a blessed message. Now this is our opportunity to support this Unity community, Unity of Charlotte. We are your church home, and we are ready to give of ourselves. And so you can, of course, mail a check to us here at Unity of Charlotte at 401 East Arrowwood Road, Charlotte, North Carolina, 28217. Or you can simply use your phone or your computer to make your offering online after this service. Just go to unityofcharlotte.org and click on the donate link. It's a secure and convenient way to keep your support flowing and your church growing. Now I invite you to hold whatever you are planning to share in your hands and to share our prosperity blessing with me. Together, joyously, I give this gift, knowing that the divine presence blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. Thank you, God. We will close at this time with our prayer of protection. Please join me. The light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us, and the presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. Thank you.